Now, our next guest is one of the country's best-loved poets. He was part of the Liverpool Beat Generation of the 1960s, pioneering accessible new poetry. I love that, Roger. I really do. It's lovely to see you on the programme. But thank you for the performance as well. You know, I was just thinking, because obviously we were looking through the various poems in the new book. Yeah. Looking back to school days, I mean, poetry was pretty boring to the majority of people. So what have poets like you done, really, to bring it all to life and popularise it?
Yes, I found it boring at school. I used to enjoy reading the poems aloud and doing choral verse. But it was when you had to study the poem and say, what did the poet mean by line 14, the word in line 14? I found that difficult. And I always wanted to write poetry for the likes of me, you know. Because anyway, I first went back to, after university, went back to be a teacher. And I was given the same books to teach from as I'd had. And I wanted to write poems for those young lads to make them enjoy it, really.
Is it a question then of breaking the rules, you know, taking the classic poetry that was, that say would have been taught in my day, and saying, right, I'm going to break the rules here a bit?
I don't know whether it's breaking the rules much, but trying to, certainly in my early days, was to write about the life that's around us, that poetry doesn't have to be about certain subjects, doesn't have to be about daffodils and, you know, the certain language of poetry. And so you can use words around us and use, you know, commercial words and television. Your subjects are around us, aren't they?
And hence keep it really updated, like liposuction.
Really, yes, liposuction, right, exactly. Yeah.
Perfect example.
Indeed.
Do you think that certain cultures appreciate and enjoy poetry more than others? I mean, I'm thinking of Ireland, obviously, vested interest here.
Love
but, but, you know, recently, a number one video there was a video of poetry, which is unlikely.
I don't know. And I know there's a Brendan Kennelly who advertises cars on the television using his poems. Yes, there's a certain tradition, the oral tradition. I've probably, coming from Liverpool, picked up some of that Irish storytelling. Because that's what poems are in a way, aren't they? It's a little story. It's a little film, really.
So when you were being taught by the Christian Brothers, tough teaching.
Tough time, yeah.
How much did they expose you then to the learnings of poetry?
Well, I have a very short little Irish Christian Brothers poem, God bless them, which went, it's like bashing your head against a brick wall, said Brother Ryan, bashing my head against a brick wall. End of poem, very short poem.
But can we just talk about that whole Liverpool thing? I mean, even the comics from Liverpool always talk about that humour and how they survived, really, through humour. Why do you think when three poets, you being one of them in the 60s, wrote this concoction of poetry that became a bestseller, why was that so popular then, do you think?
The time must have been right. I think there's a certain generation of in the 60s, going back that time, when a new generation of young people went to art college, went to university, there was a teenage sort of culture. You know, before this, we all dressed like our dads, you know, and girls dressed like their mums. And suddenly, there was money around, there was optimism in the 60s. And I suppose we as poets reflected part of that. We were the Beatles and people, young other people doing in music, or some people doing in art, fashion, we were doing in poetry.
Did you feel at the time that it was groundbreaking in terms of poetry?
I don't know. I remember I always felt not so much part of a movement as on my own. Remember, I was 17, first started writing poetry, and I felt I wanted to write poetry. Whatever I do in my life, whatever my job is, I will be a poet, and that's what I wanted to do. But then I was in Liverpool, and I was part of what was going on.
Was the scaffold a hindrance to you in the end? Were people looking at you as a pop star rather than a poet?
I think it might have been, certainly with a lot of people.
I have this marvellous picture of you, though, teaching by day and then being a poet in your spare time. So paint that picture for me.
Well, yes, I used to go to school in the day with my, you know, corduroy jacket, with the, remember the little leather thing?
Oh, yes, the leather patches.
The leather patches. And I always had a blue canvas bag, I remember, and do my day's teaching. Good teacher. Love the kids. Kids love me. Straight off out of school, straight into the nearest telephone box and change into my jeans, which were first hard to get in the early 60s, change my specs for black glasses, comb my hair forward, packed with Gauloises, French cigarettes, Moody, black polo neck, and then down to the clubs, you know, the coffee clubs, and drink watery cappuccino and talk Nietzsche and existentialism. And try and pick up girls.
And be a poet.
And be a poet, yeah.
Actually, if somebody had told you, had the vision and said to you when you were about 14, 15, 16, say, when you were growing up in Liverpool, one day you will be a world-famous poet, would that have been within the realms of your ambition or not?
Not that early, no. I think I... Because I was always told that, you know, you're not very good at anything. I wanted to... I like drawing, and I was always told you can be very good to be an artist. I thought about what it would be like to be an actor. They said, no, you can't be an actor because you're from Liverpool.
Who was saying that you couldn't be these things?
Not people weren't doing it cruelly. My parents, just the general and teachers, I suppose. Not being cruel, but protecting me. That other people have become actors, become famous. People with good educations, people with good accents. We're Liverpool working class and we have ambitions. Perhaps you can be a... With God loving, you can be a priest, or if you work hard, you can be a teacher or a doctor. But there are certain levels to which you become. And so that was certainly never in the frame, as it were.
But your mum was very encouraging for education, wasn't she?
She was. She didn't have much of education herself, nor my dad. She realised the power of education. She loved words. You know, she really loved words, loved stories, and encouraged me. And she was delighted when I first started writing poetry, as long as it wasn't rude. Gloria.
She liked the rude ones. No. Where are you going to be doing your poetry readings?
Yes, I'm off doing a tour which starts in North Wales and Conway, goes through Portsmouth and Cheltenham, Oxford, Bristol, ends up in Sheffield and Liverpool in the end of November.
Well, you're not going to see much of your kids then over the next 3 weeks.
Thanks, Gloria.
Well, I have to say that I always feel nobody reads poetry the way the writer does, so I'm thrilled you came to the house today.
Grand
Roger,
to
thank you very much indeed. Thank Roger McGough.